Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Shrine of Remembrance. My name is Dean Lee, and it's my privilege to be the Chief Executive Officer here at the Shrine, and also to welcome you. So, to begin the formalities of today, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which the Shrine is built, and I offer my respects to their elders, both past and present. There's a long history of connection to this site. I also welcome any veterans who are with us today or any active service personnel that are with us today, and thank you for what you have done for our country. As is customary before all events at the Shrine, I'd like to take a moment to honour the service and sacrifice of all Australian servicemen and women. And for those of you who are able, I'd ask that you stand. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. Lest we forget. Thank you. Please be seated. As I say, it's my pleasure to welcome you here this afternoon, and also my great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker for today, Dr. Joshua Funder. Joshua is a Rhodes Scholar with a background in biotechnology research and investment, and he worked with the Clinton Foundation's HIV and AIDS initiative in Africa, and he is currently the chair of the think tank Per Capita. In 2015, Joshua published Watson's Pier, a novel which melds fact and fiction in a moving tribute to his grandfather, Stan Watson, and the men who served at Gallipoli. The 20th of December will mark the centenary of the evacuation of Gallipoli. Joshua first heard his grandfather describe the evacuation when he was a small child, and his novel sheds light on this often overlooked aspect of Gallipoli, one of the campaign's greatest successes, and reflects on the legacy of Gallipoli in Australian history and in our identity. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Joshua Funder.
So, veterans and ladies and gentlemen, thank you for having me here today. And I too would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of this land and their elders past and present. Thanks also to Dean Lee and to Lee Gilbert for organising today. It's a real privilege to be here in this sacred place and to discuss what is coming up on the 20th of December, which is the anniversary of the evacuation of Gallipoli. And that forms a focal part for the narrative of Watson's Pier. But by no means is it focused on the narrative alone. Many of us have our stories and memories of Gallipoli, even though we weren't there. It forms part of the stories that form our individual identity, just as it forms part of the stories that form our national identity. And for over 30 years, I had those stories as part of me, and I was thinking about how best to write them down. One of the most vivid I had from my childhood was something I heard about indirectly, and I wrote it down as the starting point to writing a book, and in the end it turned out to be the first page, to my great surprise. And I'll read it now as the starting point to this talk. "Ouch," the old man whispers. The razor scrapes over his throat, coming to rest in the crease under his ear. The skin is weather-beaten, the crease a paler shade of sunburnt brown. The swollen knuckles renew their grip on the yellowing bone handle, then guide the razor up over his jaw. It's difficult on the right side where his hand is cramped and the mirror can't see the blade. He props his right elbow in the cup of his left hand to quell the tremor in his fingers. A drop of water escapes the lather and slides down his neck. It comes to rest on the seam of his vest under his right collarbone, which bears a faded yet unmistakable scar from a human bite. His left knee is wedged between the basin cabinet and the wall, and as he adjusts his stance, he feels a hinge of the cabin door dig into his thigh. The trick to shaving on the train is to get your right foot across and back from the sink to counter the regular rocking of the carriage as well as any sudden jolts. Your own reflection leads you in a tango, cheek to cheek in a mirrored ballroom for one. The country rattles by. The weak sun hasn't yet bleached the night from the morning sky. And to the west, the last lumps of the Grampians fade from view. The wheat fields are newly shorn. This early in the day, they're more shadow than stubble. a clipped mottled fleece blanketing the paddocks. Eucalyptus saplings flash past the window, punctuated by the weathered stumps of fence posts. Overhead, the telegraph wires rise in unison to each rusty pole, then trace a shallow curve down towards the land, rising and dipping endlessly, accompanying the train's clacking and rocking rhythm, the lines occasionally scored by magpies or a kookaburra. So I first heard that story when I was about 5 years old, and it was Christmas, and I was sitting at the feet of my great-grandfather after Christmas lunch, and he had a cigar and a cup of tea, and my brother and I were at his feet listening to his stories of Gallipoli. Now that's a remarkable moment for quite a few reasons. Firstly, great-grandpa was in his 90s. He had lived that long. Secondly, he was prepared to tell his story of Gallipoli. So many veterans were unable to tell their stories of Gallipoli. And also, he had been back at the age of 89 to Gallipoli for the first time. He'd mustered the courage to revisit Gallipoli himself. So it was very fresh in his mind, his images of Gallipoli and his stories of what happened back in 1915. As I listened as a young boy, I listened as hard as I could, and I engaged in a creative process where I tried to imagine what it would have been like for him as I listened to that story. And that creative empathy of listening to that story, I realized later on, is in fact a work of fiction. To truly empathize with this story, we have to take it on board, we have to imagine what it would have been like. And in doing so, we step slightly from the story itself. So that's why when I sat down to write his story, which is our story too, I was fearful, but I still thought that fiction was the right way to do it, so that each reader could also embark on their own act of creative empathy to truly engage not just in what happened, but in what happens to a person and what happens to a character when they go to war, and also what happens to a country when it goes to war. And in researching the book, I spoke with veterans recently returned from Afghanistan, and they gave me courage on a number of fronts. One of them was that they said they acknowledge, they recognize that when two men stand side by side in conflict and survive and get back to base camp, they know that each of them will tell a slightly different story of what happened. They know that. And they know that each time each of them tells that story again, it will change slightly. And when they tell a slightly changed story, their memories of it will change just that little bit as well. So this was a moment when I was the last generation to have that direct contact and hear that story directly from veterans of Gallipoli. And so I've written this for future generations. But each of those generations needs to read the stories for themselves, to not just understand the history and write it anew for their own purposes, but to use those stories in their own identity and the way they meet the challenges of their own future, which is what I've done with these stories throughout the course of my life so far. In telling one man's story, I really wanted to tell the story of Australia too. Not battle by battle, but actually one person as they go to war in preparation, in battle, in disease, in frustration, in boredom, and in survival. And that shaving scene, I didn't see. It comes from a moment when my grandmother chided my great-grandfather and said, "Dad, you really shouldn't shave on the train." He used to catch the train from Adelaide to visit us in Melbourne for Christmas. And as a young boy, I hadn't started shaving, so the idea of a man shaving every day for the next 80 years was daunting. And then I learned from Grandma that he did it with a cutthroat razor. My jaw dropped again as a young boy. The idea that a 90-year-old man would shave with a cutthroat razor on a rattling train across the plains between Adelaide and Melbourne stuck in my mind. And it stuck in my mind as the place to start writing, which I did. But it also stuck in my mind as a metaphor for Australia's expedition to Gallipoli. Our nation held a jagged razor to its own throat on the shores of Gallipoli. Watson used to joke that he did like a close shave, and that's exactly what we got. But in the evacuation, we managed to survive the very worst of it. Let me read you a related story from the book. Watson is a lieutenant. He's the leader of a signals company in Adelaide, which is the first signal-specific company in the military, as revised after Kitchener's visit to Australia. So it's the reconstituted Australian Army. He's been training in the Flinders Ranges, north of Adelaide, and his wife is pregnant with their second baby. When he gets to the station, back from training, one of his younger brother picks him up and says, Layla, his wife, has gone into labour. Layla's aunt, Gertrude Harmon, looked up and saw him standing at the door. She wouldn't stay in the bedroom, Stan, she said. Layla looked up. Stan, she whispered, where have you been? Nowhere, said Watson, moving to her. Stay with me now, she said, draping her arms over his shoulders. Layla's lip was pressed, damp to her skin. The modest edge of lace was sewn with a pale blue satin ribbon. Up so close, Watson could see each strand of the weave, the warp and the weft, glimmer crossways in the firelight. Wisps of hair escaped from her comb and brushed his temple. He could smell fresh blood and urine and sweat and smoke. Looking down, he saw two streams of fluid, one scarlet and one clear mix, as they flowed down Layla's leg and across the floor. Her forehead rested against Watson's shoulder, and she breathed hard through her mouth as the next contraction approached. Not long now, love, said Gertrude. Watson's hands clasped together at the small of Layla's back, adding to the warmth of the fire. He felt the muscles in her abdomen contract into a tight ball, drawing her ribs inwards. He felt the strength of her legs as she swayed gently with every breath. Still standing, her whole body directed the involuntary spasm to her belly. Halfway through the contraction, a shudder lifted Layla, and her open mouth came to rest on Watson's clavicle. Her teeth closed on it, and a jolt of pain shot down his right side, buckling his knee. Without relinquishing his support or breaking her focus, he slipped Layla's forehead back against his shoulder, and the contraction continued. The scar on his shoulder was there for the rest of his life, but Watson was never able to attribute the bite and his brief moment of shock to the pain Layla had endured or to the arrival of their daughter. He told people it was due to the burn from a misfired rifle. The contractions eased, and there was a lull before the pushing came on. Layla stood up, finished the verse of the song she'd been humming, and took some water. Do you know women have had the vote in South Australia for almost 20 years, Stan? She said. Yes, said Watson, not knowing exactly where this was going. And for this, said Layla, as the first push took her breath, and she leaned on Watson's shoulder again. On the next push, Gertrude felt the head. On the next, it emerged, and on the third, the shoulders were clear. Layla reached down between her legs and took the baby. Her arms were shaking. The infant was blue, wet and slippery with blood and vernix. Layla held the baby to her chest and kissed and smelled the head. Looking at Watson, she held up the infant's face so they could both see it. Watson put one arm round Layla and one arm under the baby. Hello, he whispered, blowing on the tiny blue lips. Hello. The baby's lips quivered. Its mouth opened, and with a gasp, its first breath rippled through the tiny body. So for me, that is the birth of a nation. In a kitchen in Adelaide in 1913, it's also the birth of my grandmother Ruth, who you'll see in the wheelbarrow on the pictures. She's the one on the right. It's very closely based on the birth of my second daughter as well, just as Ruth was Watson's second daughter. And in telling that story, again, I wasn't there, it's clearly fictionalised, but I was very much there for the birth of my second daughter. I wanted to make some very clear points about our understanding of Gallipoli. Firstly, Gallipoli was not the birth of a nation. Birth is not an appropriate metaphor for war, any war, but particularly the wholesale slaughter of the First World War. Australia was well and truly born. I made reference there to the female vote earlier than almost any other country in the world. By 1914, when we went to war, we didn't just have the female vote, we had the pension, we had the 888 movement and the harvest of judgment. on almost any measure, we were the richest country in the world. We'd built libraries, we'd built cities, we'd invented our own football code, we'd sent Mawson to the South Pole. We did all of that under the aegis of a colony and after Federation. Australia was well and truly born. In fact, we were more than that. We were effortlessly exceptional before the First World War. And the First World War was no birth. It put us back. Two generations of leadership were lost. It wasn't until well after the Second World War that Australia made any effort to recover any form of leadership. We had a Great Depression. We had the Spanish flu epidemic. We had the Second World War, but we had no Roaring Twenties, and we had no Roaring Fifties in Australia. Australia, for me, had a stillbirth, and I'll get to that later on. But to me, the First World War is a better metaphor for the First World War is stillbirth. That story is also a prelude to a very different metaphor for the unknown soldier. That stillbirth to me, Watson's third child, he left his wife pregnant as they went to war. That metaphor of stillbirth to me, another daughter born at home, but born dead, is a metaphor for the war and potentially for the unknown soldier. Not the unknown soldier, the military fighter who we should rightly commemorate, but the other unknown victims of war, those left behind at home, those whose fathers came home but were emotionally damaged and were another form of loss, not just physical loss. Watson was one of the few soldiers and volunteers who were married, let alone had children, when the war broke. It is a sobering statistic that there are very few armies in the world where any more than 10% of the men are married. We tend to send single young men off to war. And later on in the book, I tried to write and describe the moment when Watson has sent a cable to his commanding officer the night before Australia declares war, when that declaration is imminent, volunteering to enlist formally, form the signals company, and embark for war. And the next day, the message comes through. Mid-morning at work, he goes to enlist, gets a tooth pulled in case it might force trouble later on. He misses lunch. He goes home to his wife and children and says that he's enlisting. He hasn't consulted with her. He's going to leave for war. And at that stage, and even right through to the departure of the fleet from Albany, they didn't know who the enemy was and they didn't know where they'd be fighting. But he enlisted nonetheless. And I don't know what it is, what that gap and absence is between a man and a wife or a man and his country when you enlist before and leave children at home. And when I look at my two children, who are roughly the same age as Watson's when he left, I can't imagine that. So I leave it to you, the reader, to try and help me understand that moment. For me, it's a gap. For me, it's a effort of fiction and wonder for us all to try and imagine what that would be like to say goodbye and to understand your motives. Now, in terms of those motives, my reading of the language of those men at the time and women is that they really did enlist for God, King, country, and a lark. Many of them saw it as a sense of adventure. It was also the case that they had unrealistic expectations that the war would be brief. But when they went to battle, those were not the motives that took those men over the top. And in terms of the birth of a country, I refute that this was Australia's birth, but it was nonetheless important for our identity. Watson travelled to Broadmeadows here to camp, to train a little bit, to enlist men, as many as they could, as good a men as they could. They set sail for Albany, where the fleet gathered on the edge of this great continent, but didn't get out of the boats. So it wasn't until those men arrived at Mena in Egypt and got out of the boats and off the trains that they realised what they had in common. Men from all corners of Australia who hadn't yet met because of transport back then. It was a very dispersed continent. And they realised what they had in common culturally and in terms of their way of mateship. And they realised how that was different from the Egyptians, from the English, from the New Zealanders, and later on when they met French and other Canadian soldiers. So I think it was a point in our national identity when we recognised what we had in common, we recognised how that was different from other countries. But by no means was it the birth. But that then takes us forward into the story of mateship through the First World War. there was a pre-existing and strong spirit of mateship amongst Australians, and it wasn't some apocryphal myth from the bush. Most of the Australians who enlisted were from the cities. We were already a very urbanised country. They had soft hands, just like me, with no experience of war. But the sense of mateship was there to start with, and that was one of the reasons they enlisted. But when we track that through to a fatal landing, to going over the top against the odds, we can see that in Egypt, that sense of mateship was matured and evolved. We can also see in the doctor's reports and the British command reports that despite terrible circumstances and horrific physical malaise, the Australians maintained their morale. So mateship was by all means made, and it was used in the course of a Gallipoli campaign, and used well. It was used well in the evacuation, and we'll get to that as well. But when I read the words of veterans from the First World War, when they were about to go over the top, it was not God, King or country that motivated them to go over the top. It was their mates. But that gets to be circular. The Turks had their mates too. The Germans had their mates too. And what we do when we send men to war is we conflate mateship that is so strong and so human and so powerful that men will go to their death for it, with geopolitics and missions and strategies. And that's a necessary evil of war. But in some circumstances, we didn't just make and use mateship, but that mateship was abused. So I don't think we should glorify mateship. I don't think mateship is one thing. We should understand the full complexity of Australian mateship and the ways in which during the course of this war it wasn't just made and used, but also abused. And in that way, mateship will serve the needs of our young men and women into the future much better, because they will be able to draw on a wide range of understandings of what that term means for Australians and how they can use it to strengthen their lives and draw on each other. Let me read you another part of the book. None of these are very military, but I guess that's a reflection of what I'm trying to say through the course of the book. When Watson was 89, as I mentioned, he revisited Gallipoli, physically went back. In 1976, he was there on the beach on Anzac Day, and there was no throng of young people or old then. It was a very lonely effort. But he also visited Constantinople, Istanbul, which was the ultimate objective of the whole mission, and it was a form of quest late in life for Watson to revisit that magnificent city. And this is what he finds as an old man the first morning he wakes up in Istanbul. Mustafa is his driver, and Michelson is an attaché from the consulate who's been sent along to chaperone Watson, the old digger that they don't want to lose as he goes about his business in Turkey. "I thought this was a mosque," Watson said. "Atatürk turns it into a museum in the 30s, said Michelson. Watson looked up. The edifice stretched beyond the periphery of his vision, his mind unable to encompass this most remarkable monument. The greatest church in Christendom, the most beautiful mosque in all Islam. And, almost 50 years ago, Atatürk, father of modern Turkey, had gifted to the world this ancient holy place as a secular shrine." Watson glanced at Mustafa, who shook his head, declined to join them, and retreated to the company of the stallholders by the perimeter wall. Leaving the bright daylight outside, they entered the dimness of the narthex. Shuffling along with the crowd, eyes adjusting to the light, they passed through the huge brass-studded imperial doors. Watson craned his neck upwards. High above, the vast dome, like a gilded birdcage, recreated the heavens. Golden beams of light streamed down from the windows circling the gallery. Gentle zephyrs of dust swirled up to greet them. Huge stone pillars held this whole universe aloft. Tourists scurried about the major sites, heads down in guidebooks, while a few lonely worshippers respectfully aligned themselves with the decommissioned mirror, heads down in prayer. Watson stood on the stone slab in a beam of light, joining the direction of their prayers. He shifted slightly to the left to face the original eastern altar, then returned to face Mecca. Satisfied that the sunbeam didn't flinch, he proceeded to explore the rest of the place. So Watson goes back to revisit Gallipoli, and my attempt here is that we revisit Gallipoli with him, just as we are revisiting Gallipoli here today. And I think there was a real element of quest and bravery for him to revisit Gallipoli, not just as a tourist, but to revisit it, what it meant for him in his story and his history and his understanding of what had happened at the time. And I think that bravery is what we also need to draw on and embark on ourselves to revisit it, to make sure we can understand the story and its meaning for each one of us. But I wrote that story for a number of other reasons as well. Prior to the war, Germany had allied itself with the Ottoman Empire. At that stage, the clear caliphate, the host of Islam in the world. And at the same time, the British Empire had allied itself with Egypt, another Muslim state. Turkey had declared a holy jihad. And God was on both sides of this war. That was no reason for this conflict, and certainly it was no solution to the conflict either. And so Watson testing the sunbeam of light and its relationship to the heavens is a metaphor for the curious and sad role that religion played in this war. But much more than that, it's also a monument. In the 30s, Ataturk had gifted the Hagia Sophia to the world. It had been the absolute apex of Christian faith. And then it moved to be the greatest mosque in all Islam, and he had said this will be a secular gift to the world. Now, in an age now of terrorism and global religious mistrust, we don't have the leadership or the currency or the gestures to try and solve our problems just as Ataturk had tried then. But it's also a sad reminder that while the Hagia Sophia is still standing, and it is still the most remarkable museum, those gestures have done little to solve those same problems that we face now in global conflict and terror. I want to focus now in terms of the story on what I believe is a tipping point in the Australian history of Gallipoli, and it's an untold one. And it goes to this picture here, which is the cover of the book. Now, the black and white original of this picture was on my grandmother's wall for as long as I can remember it. So it's burnt deeply in the imagery and the stories of my own identity. And what we did here is we washed it with the sort of colours that the people in 1915 used to put, the tints and the blush that they used to put on photos. And in this case, that's the blush of fiction that I am applying to the history, which I follow very closely in the book. And then, of course, we've got these poppies, and they are not just metaphorical, as anyone who's walked in here today under a canopy of poppies can feel their presence, but they're also metaphors for the bombs that were falling on Watson as he was building Watson's Pier. This photo is of Anzac Cove. The Turks can see from every vantage point these men stuck out in the middle of the cove building a pier. Watson was the first to build a pier. There were other piers built later. And what had happened here is that the landing was a debacle, and we rightly attribute a large part of the debacle of the landing to the British Navy and the British Army and their incompetence and lack of contingency planning, amongst other things. What we don't do is acknowledge our part in those failures of the landing. The Australians back in Egypt had trained very hard and very well. When they saw some of the English men who had just been recruited to the army, they were shocked. Those men at 19, joining the army from the peasantry in England, had typically grown 3 inches and put on a stone, and yet they were still smaller than their officers and certainly smaller than the Australians. The mother country at that time was not feeding its men enough. At 19, they were still waiting for their full complement of protein. Their bones had not yet finished growing. And so they did look up to their officers in England, sadly, because those officers ate better than them. And they looked up to the Australians. And the Australians saw that in their training, and they were shocked at what had happened in Australia and this extraordinary country that we had built and what was really happening back in England. But they trained well, and they trained very professionally and very hard. But fundamentally, they had no experience of war. and the experience of war was the only preparation they really needed. So at the landing, they scurried up into the hills in a form of attack that was not very well coordinated, and Watson played his part in the failure of the landing. He was unable to get communications to the front, which was his job, to coordinate those attacks. So we had a moment of not just British naval and military failure, but also of Australian small group larrikin heroism and a lack of ability to coordinate. And I think that burnt deeply on Watson, the failures of the landing and his role in it, not just through inexperience, but the inability to get communications to that front as it moved up into those very steep hills. So we need to acknowledge that part of the landing, and then you get these funny stories that really touch home. You'll see some men being dragged into shore on a boat, and that's Watson. It's a very typical photo of the landing. And on the way in, they had a bet with his senior officer, amongst three of them, who could grow the best beard by the time they got to Constantinople. And you can just imagine Australians doing something as inane as that, a bet about beards. And then you'll see another one of these photos of four fellows looking pretty scruffy, standing outside a dugout. And that's those same fellows, about 2 or 3 weeks later. And even by that early stage, they realised that they were at a likely stalemate. And they shaved those beards off on the beach one morning in a sombre ceremony, really. So early on, they recognised the situation they were in, and they recognised the likely futility of the campaign. And that photo of Watson's pier comes after Watson had got signals to the front line, and he then didn't have enough to do. He was getting in his commanding officer's hair, and as a trained engineer, they volunteered him to build the pier. And that was no insignificant moment, because it was at all times during construction either the first or second most dangerous place at Gallipoli, depending on how much Quinn's post was copping it. So he didn't have too much trouble scrounging the materials to build the pier. There was a bridging train ship that had been filled with wood to build a railway across the peninsula, presuming a successful landing. But finding the men was much harder, because it involved such exposure to such abject risk. So he scrounged the men, he scrounged the wood, he made a design as an engineer, and he set about building that pier. And in building that pier, they were certainly building a pier to land more men and material. They were also building a pier to make sure that men who were injured could be evacuated without wading them through the shallows and causing further harm and injury. But thirdly, they knew that that pier would likely be necessary for an evacuation at some stage in the future. So shaving on the beach, those scraggy beards that didn't make it to Constantinople, and starting to build the pier is, I think, a very early tipping point in the mentality of the Australians. In building the pier, they had the men and the wood, but they didn't have a pile driver. Watson remembered that the ship, the Barbarossa, had sent a armour-piercing shell all the way across the peninsula. It had missed the ship for which it was targeted and landed just by Watson's dugout. With no training in artillery or ammunition, he went, screwed the cap off the back of it, pulled out the explosive charge, had his men collect shrapnel from the beach as a dead weight, filled the shell with the dead weight, screwed the cap back on, had someone weld a hook on the top and use that as the pile driver. So here we have, and he did say that was one of the scariest moments of the whole war, including the 3 years after Gallipoli that he spent relentlessly on the Western Front. So that means it was a pretty important moment in his management of fear throughout the course of the war. But it also becomes emblematic for me, having looked at this so many different ways at so many different times in my life. This is a moment of men building something and constructing something while all around them destruction reigns. The shell is a form of swords to plowshares in the midst of carnage. The men are building their own exodus, their own exit from hell. It's also a tipping point in the Australian command. What happened when they'd finished the pier was that they wanted to celebrate. And they knew that the English commanders wouldn't give them a rum ration just for doing their job. So some bright spark remembered that that day, the 18th of June 1915, was the centenary of the Battle of Waterloo, when the British won. And 100 years before then, tens of thousands of men had marched into fields in red coats and done battle, and at the end of the day declared victory and gone home. And not a lot changed in the villages, and not a lot changed in the cities. And so here we have men knowing they're at a stalemate, in building a pier under abject duress, celebrating a very different circumstance. Not victory, but loss. Not a war that can be conducted in fields, but a war that is already killed 1 million people by that stage, involving civilian and military, involving geopolitics and whole industrial complexes. So they sit down to a dinner, having got the rum ration through to celebrate the anniversary of Waterloo 100 years before. And so when we celebrate Gallipoli, we're also celebrating the bicentenary of the Battle of Waterloo, and the contrast could not be sharper. I was lucky enough to go back on June the 18th this year to Gallipoli, and for the second time visit that very powerful place. And I was able to swim out in the cove and dive down through the water and touch the footings of the pier that are still rammed home in the seabed. And it's remarkable, but the physical legacy of Watson's Pier is not what this is about. When I went back for the first time as a student to research the book and to visit the place, I bought a Turkish map. And on that Turkish map are the Turkish names and place names for all the villages. But jutting out into Anzac Cove, in neat cursive, are the words Watson's Pier. It remains on the maps and in our hearts, even though it's long ago washed away. And it remains in my heart as a tipping point for the war. The men sat down that night to dinner, and they wrote a remarkable menu. And you'll see that flash by as well. And oysters will be served very much on the shell as they burst around. Wheelbarrows will be called at 25:45, this apocryphal time past midnight. And when great-grandpa told me that story, I said, "Great-grandpa, did you really have a feast in the middle of the war?" And he said, "No, of course not. We ate bully beef and hardtack." But 13 men sat down to dinner that night to celebrate and commemorate the successful completion of Watson's Pier, and they embarked on a collective flight of fancy to escape their horror with humour and camaraderie. But 13 men sitting down is biblical. Watson wouldn't sign the menu, as all 12 others had, because he thought it was unlucky. The idea of not signing a menu determining your fate while war reigns is a remarkable insight into the mindset of escape that those men needed in order to get through. It's also a military tipping point, an important one to recognise. Not just for that moment of exodus and salvation and a biblical dinner amongst 13 men. From that point on, I think many of the commander's minds turned towards evacuation. And those lessons of the landing were learnt. The landing was a cock-up under British command, and the evacuation was a remarkable military feat, largely under Australian command. And I think we can learn very different things from the evacuation and from the landing than we currently do. I think it's healthy that we commemorate a failed landing. It's unlikely that Australia is going to get triumphal about celebrating and commemorating the landings at Gallipoli, and that's a healthy thing. But at the same stage, I don't think we should necessarily take all our learnings from it about the failures of larrikin heroism, or simply blame the British. Those are not adequate learnings from the landing. But from the evacuation, we can learn quite different things. And the starting point to those is the role of genius, military genius or civilian genius, in leading. Brudenell White was the commander who was the inspiration for the evacuation. The Anzacs had no space in which to retreat, and instead he generated the time in which to retreat. They introduced intermittent warfare, 2 or 3 days on, fighting futilely, and taking risks when you knew you wouldn't get through, 2 or 3 days off, resisting the urge to fire when the Turks were firing back at you. And over a series of about 6 weeks, that intermittent warfare lulled the Turks into a routine that gave the Anzacs time where they had no space in which to retreat. So that's the first point, genius and leadership. The second one was bureaucracy and paperwork and administration and our excellence in the evacuation at exactly those things that are essential to any large-scale achievement. And Watson was part of that. You'll see here his handwritten notes of the signals that they needed to build specific for the evacuation. You'll see here a list of men. It says the disposition of the Second Signals Company. And I had Watson's manuscript. He was brave enough to write one in his early 90s. I've had that since I was in my early 20s. And I've read that many times. And I read the disposition of the Second Signals Company, Second Divisional Signals Company, many times without really understanding what it meant. And as I researched the book and researched around those moments in history, things started to fall into place. And one day, I was in the midst of a house which we were renovating. It was unheated. I was wearing a beanie, sitting on a dusty camp chair, trying to finish off this book. And I was freezing cold in a dusty room. And I realised that on the 16th of December 1915, when Watson had dated that list, he was sitting in a cave, flea-ridden cave, where the Egyptian muleteers used to store their animals. But even the cave was too horrible for them, and they moved out. And it was the last bolt hole where he was stuck. Signals ran from there. It was called the Keep. And he sat down on the 16th of December 1915 and wrote a list. And then it dawned on me what that list was. Watson had to write a list of the sappers who would stay to the very last and check every man off. And on the 16th of December, they had no expectation whatsoever that they would live. The British had the expectation that there would be the standard 20 to 40% losses, standard cannon fodder. And all that excellence in leadership and all that Australian administration and excellence in bureaucracy gave them an expectation that the losses might be lower. But for the last 21 men to leave, they really didn't have any idea that they would get away. At very best, they might be taken hostage, or captured prisoner by the Turks. So Watson sits down to write a list, and the first person on that list is his commanding officer, Gould. And actually, he's lucky. He gets to go 24 hours early, like most of the other senior officers, so he's probably safe. And then Watson, and then 19 young men. And I'm sitting there writing with cold fingers on a computer, safe as I can be, and I try and understand what it's like for a man to write the names in pencil of the 19 of his best men who he is consigning to likely death. And so that's when I started to learn quite different things about the evacuation and what it can mean. And not just at the genius and not just at the administration, but at the individual courage. The third major element of the evacuation was that each man was delegated and trusted to find his own way out, to practice it, not to crack under pressure, not to give the game away. And the remarkable thing is that they all did. So I think the evacuation can serve quite a different role in our understanding of what we did so well in our exodus. I think it can do something else as well. And that is to provide us with a common and positive moment in our history that we can share with the Turks. I think we should celebrate Anzac Night on the 20th or the 19th of December each year as a compliment to Anzac Day. Anzac Day rightly commemorates a failed landing, and we can learn from that. Anzac Night should commemorate a successful exodus of the Australians. It should also commemorate, alongside the Turks, the moment at which they got their homeland back. Gallipoli was the place where the Ottoman Empire died. Modern Turkey wasn't born till sometime afterwards, but it was at that moment that we can share our common and positive history with Turkey hand in hand. Anzac Day alone relies on Turkish generosity that we celebrate with them our invasion of their homeland. I think Anzac Night can serve quite a different set of learnings and quite a different purpose in our shared history, which is essential. That's the first point I'd like to make about new things we need to learn from Anzac, and one of them would be this year, on the centenary, to informally introduce the concept of Anzac Night and take those learnings forwards for the next generations who might read with their own empathy and for their own history these stories that we bequeath them. The second thing I wanted to claim in this lecture is a different understanding of lest we forget. When I read the words of the veterans, they meant two very clear things by lest we forget. And I think we have indeed forgotten one of them. They certainly meant don't forget us, don't forget our sacrifice and our service. And we understand that today. And when we commemorate Gallipoli, we remember the sacrifice and service that is in some ways beyond our comprehension today. but they meant a second thing. Watson and his contemporaries were unequivocal in the language they used to describe this war. It was futile. It was stupid. They didn't want us to forget what a stupid and futile war this was, but I think we do. Because if we say it was a stupid and futile war now, we think we might do a disservice to their sacrifice. And I don't think that's true. And I don't think they wanted us to forget the folly of this war. And they certainly wanted us never to embark on a war of such disastrous proportions or such false pretenses. So when I think about the term lest we forget, I think we should do them the honour of learning from this war quite differently, taking it forward into our identity as we meet the challenge of the future, and never forget the stupidity and folly of this war, and make sure that we don't repeat that. And on that, we can see that the losses from this war are different from those ones conceived of at the time. When I wrote that birth scene, I wanted to show different metaphors for blood, not just the blood of a healthy young man shot in the shoulder, but the blood of the miracle of birth. There are different forms of blood in war, of the putrid and rotting corpse, of stillborn baby whose blood never goes from blue to pink. There are different forms of pain, not just that physical pain we often associate with masculinity in war, and not just the pain that women expect when they have childbirth. Funny story, most men when they have a heart attack think it's the most painful thing that they've ever experienced. Most women who have a heart attack think it's the second most painful thing they've ever experienced. And so when we think about pain in war and masculine pain, I think we need to think more broadly than that. Not just childbirth and getting shot, the pain of being away from home, the pain of that emotional distance when they were away, and the pain of the emotional distance when they got home and couldn't reconnect. The pain of shell shock and the pain of PTSD, the pain of confusion, the pain of betrayal. There are a wide range of mateship, of pain, of blood. And I think we need to expand those metaphors and what we can learn from them to provide a broader currency and language for our future generations. But unless we forget, I think there is a better way we can commemorate the legacy of Anzac in the next century. Australia has spent $550 million and rising on the commemoration of the centenary, and that's twice as much as all the other parties to the war combined. Now, I do suggest we reclaim an effortless exceptionalism in all sorts of things in our country and learn from that part of the build-up to the First World War. But spending that much on new monuments and new backwards-looking commemoration, I think, is a missed opportunity. And instead, what I propose today, and I've proposed before, but I think we should work on, is an Anzac Trust. And that Anzac Trust is a forward-looking commemoration and monument, and it's a virtual monument. And it's to endow the Anzac Trust with funds adequate for future generations of servicemen and women returning to Australia, to ensure their physical repatriation, to ensure their emotional and psychological repatriation, and to ensure the repatriation of their military skills into civilian workforce and employment. Now, I think if we think of lest we forget as backward-looking, never forgetting the service and sacrifice of those men, but forward-looking as well, never forget the folly of war or the unmet needs of the diggers that return physically intact but emotionally troubled, an Anzac Trust would be a better way to commemorate and an apt way to never forget. Those are some of the things I meant in writing a fictional novel about our common history and writing it for future generations. But there's a lot more there than that. I would love to hear your questions and continue the conversation now outside, and also by all means contact me in the future as you might read the book and have questions of your own at a later date. Thank you very much.
Well, I think you would agree with me that was a deeply thoughtful and provocative, in a positive way, to our own concepts of war and of the activities which occurred at Gallipoli. It's in my mind, of course, that at this evacuation time, these men were only a few weeks or a week and a bit from Christmas, much as we are now, and you wonder what it meant for them at that time. I'd ask you once again to join with me in thanking Dr. Joshua Funder for his thought-provoking presentation. And on behalf of the shrine, I offer you this gift. Thank you.
Do you want questions?
Yes, if you'd like to ask questions, we'd be very happy.
Thank you.
Sorry.
I'll tuck this under my arm and take questions. Are there any questions? While you're thinking, down there, please.
Oh, I'd just like to thank you for, I've never heard it presented in such a way, but the whole humanity of the whole experience and of your great-grandfather. And I just like to ask you a personal question. What do you think that you learnt from your great-grandfather that makes you who you are today?
It's a very personal question, I know. But I was very impressed.
Thank you for the question. And let me answer it in a couple of different ways. I was at a lunch at Legacy last week and speaking about how those members of the community identified themselves as legatees. And this is a form of legacy that I've been bequeathed. What have I learned? And what was interesting to discuss with them is that historically our conception of legatee and legacy was of those children raised to men who died overseas. And then it expanded to some of the men who died prematurely from their injuries, physical injuries, when they returned home. But what we started that day was a conversation about the men who did return home physically intact, but were still very distant from their children. They had encountered loss, but it was not physically apparent. And that the children also suffered from that loss, even though their fathers, in some cases their mothers, returned healthy. So I was learning then in that discussion with legatees about perhaps expanding the idea that almost all servicemen and women suffer severe loss in their service, physically or emotionally, and that those descendants are all in some ways legatees. Now that's the legacy of loss and the legacy of not having a direct story. And so my answer to you is I think there are parts of this story that I've been bequeathed from his revisiting Gallipoli, his doing me the great honour and privilege of telling me his story. But I think there are also gaps there in his return to Australia, and some, I'm sure there are parts of the story that he didn't tell that reflect that loss and reflect the legacy of things bequeathed and the legacy of things unsaid. So my answer is I think part of the legacy is what I heard and part of the legacy is probably what I didn't hear. I don't know what that was, but I think we have to recognise things unsaid and things unspoken as part of the loss and legacy that we all have from that war.
I was wondering, what will you be doing on the 19th of December? Yourself. December, I should say. 19th of December.
You have to smile. There was an article in the papers today about who was the last to leave, and in Bean's official history, Patton and Staverley, the military and naval commanders together, were the last to leave. It was about 3:30 in the morning. And one of the things I wanted to write very clearly in this book about the history of the evacuation was an attempt to correct the historical record. And Watson was adamant that he was the second last man to leave Gallipoli. And he was adamant about that because he said that in a way that he wanted very clearly to preserve the legacy and contribution of Littler, who was the beachmaster. And according to my account, which is verified by Littler's family and other historians as well, it was at about 3:30 in the morning that the Australians fired the mines under the neck. And they did that needlessly. Watson and the evacuation at that stage were going smoothly. The men were getting clear. And Watson, I think, his mission and his quest was to have the evacuation so successful in the extraordinary unlikely event, so successful that the Turks would wake up the next morning none the wiser and the Australians would have flown. The military command couldn't resist pulling the trigger and detonating that mine. And that was a fate that was problematic for two main reasons. Firstly, 70 or more Turks were unnecessarily killed. It was punching someone on the nose when you're already leaving the fight. It was not a moment of great generosity of spirit by the Australians, and we need to recognise that for what it tells us about ourselves, and also recognise that as an acknowledgement to an unnecessary loss that we incurred, induced for the Turks. So we need to learn that. But it was also the fact that Watson then still hadn't cleared the front line, and it put him under enormous duress. All hell broke loose at 3:30 in the morning. Staveley and Patton scurried off in a cutter, but they hadn't cleared the beach. Watson had to run down to the southern beach, send the final signal to the Navy, scurry back all the way along Anzac Cove, and leave from North Beach with Littler. They left at about 4:10, 4:15 a.m. And so on that night, on the 19th, the morning of the 20th, what will I be thinking about? I'll be thinking about how history is true or not, how those different stories amount to an understanding of the facts of the evacuation, but also an example of how history can be twisted. Now, in 1955, Watson went to visit Bean as he was ill and dying. And he was a friend of Bean's from their experience together in the war, and they spoke about the various stories. And one of them that Watson wanted to assert to Bean was Littler's legacy in being clearly the last man to leave the beach. And everybody who wrote about that would understand that Littler would never have left the beach before every last man was off. He went into battle with nothing but a stick. Ultimately, caused the loss of his life at Mouquet Farm in 1916. I think the Germans didn't have a sense of humour for men going in with a stick against a machine gun, and they didn't bother to spare him then. But he wasn't able to preserve his legacy about who was the last to leave, and Watson did. Bean wrote Watson a letter saying, of course, Watson, you're right. Patton and Staveley were probably, you know, we argued about it, but it could only have been Littler to be the last, and that makes sense. But Bean didn't publish that letter, so I've published it here in the book as one of the true letters. Some others are fictionalised. I do set out to correct the historical record, but it's also to show the fog of war and the ambiguity of our own commonly accepted history now, 100 years later, and the need for each of us to reread that history, feel, empathise, and create for ourselves the emotional impact of that history for future reference. So I think that's what I'll be doing between 3:30 and 4:15 on the morning of the 20th, is thinking those sorts of thoughts.
Thank you, Joshua. My question for you is, just with your reference to history and what we should read, do you have a favourite account either of Gallipoli or of, and by favourite I mean a historian who I guess relates the events in a way that touches you? I'm not quite sure what I mean by that, but do you have historians whose way of telling the histories of either Gallipoli, or I'll narrow it to World War One, but of any sort of history that that you like or you appreciate? Or?
Well, I'll tell another story to try and answer that question as best I can. One of the things that touched me in the process of writing and then publishing this book was at the launch, when Major General John Cantwell launched the book. Now, he'd been a tank commander in the First Iraq War, a senior commander in the Second Iraq War. He'd been the commander of all the Australian forces in Afghanistan. And he returned to Australia with the expectation that he would be one of two people considered to be the head of the army. And instead, he checked himself into a clinic with acute PTSD. And at the launch, he said two things that touched me. Firstly, he had read all the non-fiction accounts of Gallipoli as a professional soldier and a history buff, but that Watson's Pier, as a fictional book, took him on an emotional journey that was true to his experience of contemporary war. And so I think there's a role for fiction and non-fiction. And what I would counsel you against is reading too many pieces of non-fiction that are, here's a young fella about to go over the top, here's a letter home to his girlfriend, goes over the tops and dies, we move to another battle. Because when I read individual stories and letters, that's not my understanding of war and what's true to the experience of war. So he did say that this was true to his experience of the emotional arc of battle and war. And as a civilian, again, I was encouraged to hear that. But he also said something else. He said he read out a couple of paragraphs that he liked, and then he read out one paragraph. I'll read it out to you because I think it goes to your point about how we can better understand war as true to soldiers as well as ourselves. So Watson's gone to the front because he can't get signals when they're landing on the 25th of April 1915. And he scurries up and he takes with him a fellow called Fitzroy, who's a young fellow he picked up in Fitzroy. He's an orphan, and Watson's become a former father figure for him. And just as they've got the cable connected and they're about to go back down, they stand up and shrapnel explodes above them, and a little piece of it rips off Fitzroy's jaw, and his throat is gaping. His saliva gland is spurting into nowhere, and Watson throws up. He vomits. It's a visceral reaction. And at that point, he searches for words to try and understand and control this horror. And that's what writers and historians do. We search for words to try and understand and control and relate this horror. But we do it very poorly. So in that moment, Watson finally grasps the word epiglottis, because that's what's hanging down at the back of Fitzroy's throat. It's all that he can see. But that really doesn't capture the horror that he's struggling to feel. And then this is the paragraph that Cantwell read out that I wrote, trying to capture a particular moment that is true to soldiers. A sour taste lingered in Watson's mouth. Then another wave of emotion rose up within him. He suppressed it savagely. This was a time to think and act, not to try and understand. Watson knew that if he didn't push his feelings away, his nerve would fail. Detachment, he saw the scene from above, saw himself slipping down the slope. Detachment now served a clear and present purpose. It bought time and sanity and survival. Detachment was an involuntary pact that he quickly made with his future self, one that would leave him numb and searching for his senses evermore. So that's the moment when Watson encounters battle and the horror of battle. And when I read the letters around Watson from his contemporaries, they said he was very cool under pressure. And I wondered at what cost, how he didn't suffer from shell shock or fear as much as others. And I think I'm trying to capture there how he pushed his emotions away. So as we read war, historians or fiction, I had a real challenge in relating that in words to try and capture those moments. And one of the challenges is, when I spoke with veterans from Afghanistan, when I spoke with veterans from the Second World War, when I spoke with children of Holocaust survivors, fiction is usually about conveying a character's emotions. And some of the survivors of war are very good at hiding their emotions, certainly until they get home. And that paragraph was true to John Cantwell as an experience of war and that moment. But it's very hard to write after that, because people ask, what's Watson thinking and feeling after he's had that shock? And I said, I don't think he is, so I'm writing as if he's not. I'm trying to be true to his experience, but it's not true to the expectations of what a reader would do. When you read the letters of the nurses, for instance, they start out describing things as they're happening, and you can see how they self-censor and block out. So they start writing about the weather, because it's too much. So as you read history, fiction, non-fiction, you have to read what's there, what's spoken and what's unspoken, and you have to try and understand the horror of war as experienced through the emotional situation of soldiers and servicewomen. I can't give you specific guides to books, but I'd hope that might provide part of your compass as we all navigate these stories for our own purposes.
Thank you, Joshua. I'm not sure actually how to ask this question. I prefer not to make it too personal. And it could become very personal. It somewhat saddens me in the state of the world we're living in at present, with ISIS and all the others, that I don't think we realise as a nation of Australians the wonderful contacts that we can have with the Turkish people, which I do. And it seems sad that we don't reflect on this more often, because we tend to judge the Muslims totally as being all the same. But even this morning, I was with the Turkish people. I happen to be an architect and I do a lot of work for them. And how it all started was quite remarkable, because when I first met them as an architect, and they offered to take me to Istanbul to look at the mosque there, they were quite wonderful to me. And they said they'd look after me for 3 or 4 days. and what would I like to do for the rest of the time? And I'm sorry to swear, but I was sitting with the Turkish consul at the time, and I think these bastards were killing our grandfathers on Gallipoli. And he turned to me and he said, "You're in Australia, you don't want to go to Gallipoli." But I have made great friends with him, and I think we should sustain this friendship, and I'm not sure how that should happen, but it's there to be taken if we want to. I don't know how you comment on that. I don't know.
I'll comment in three different ways. I knew a fellow once who was a psychiatric ethnogeographer, and he made one thing I'll never forget. He said that the differences between individuals within any cultural group or nation are so vastly wide that the differences between any group or nation are very hard to measure. So I don't think we should make broad generalisations. Secondly, I was discussing with Dean earlier, following the First and Second World Wars, one of the great hopes I have for humanity and for civilisation is that the value of people now vastly outweighs the value of coal and gold and farms. And the example given in a book I'm reading just at bedtime every night now is that if China invaded California, all the Silicon Valley guys could move to India and all the to do their computing and software programming. All of Hollywood could move to India too, to Bollywood. And the Chinese would be left with, a few farms and a bit of coastline. And that valuation of people as the ultimate resource now in a very sophisticated global economy means that individuals and communities and their trade is much more valuable than the sorts of things, land and geography, that people were fighting over in the First World War. So my hope is that as we come to value people, other nations in particular, and we will get better at leaving them alone and finding much more constructive ways to engage with them and much more constructive ways to avoid war. Now, that doesn't give us the tools on some of the really tribal and ethnic schisms. The Muslim religion isn't the cause of ISIS. That's an unfair generalisation. So I think there is hope to not generalise, to understand the value of humans. I also think in shared moments like Anzac Night, we can do a much better job at relating to other communities in our shared history. Never forget that Gallipoli is much more important to the Turks than it is for us. Australians like to think it's seminal in our history. Every Turkish school kid has an obligation to visit Turkey at one point. And Turkey is a very big country. It's a very long way to go from eastern Turkey to Gallipoli, but they do. Çanakkale Day, which is the day that the Turks resisted the assault of the British Navy, is monumental in comparison with Anzac Day. So we share a common history, but theirs is even more powerful. Never forget that they were defending their homeland. They went over the top for their mates and to defend their homeland. We didn't have that excuse. So I think we have a lot in common. We can have ongoing engagement at all sorts of levels, and we can share our positive moments of history, and Anzac Night is very much one of those.
Thanks once again, Joshua, and thank you all again for your attendance. And on behalf of the Shrine, I invite you to stay on for the rest of the afternoon if you'd like to and explore the Galleries of Remembrance or our new postcards exhibit, which is in the Visitor Centre, or the Dyson exhibition, which we have in the End of the First World War Gallery, featuring all of the culture cartoons and the other political commentary which came from Australia's first war artist. Thank you once again. Good evening. Thank you.